Hallelujah. Good evening, everyone. This is Bishop Mel. We are now in a portion where we can share with you the Holy Word of God. Tonight, the title of the message tonight is, He Came to Fulfill the Promise. He came to fulfill the promise. We're going to our text tonight in the book of Matthew chapter 1, Isaiah chapter 7, the book of Hebrews chapter 13, the book of John chapter 14, and Deuteronomy chapter 17. Let me just open up in prayer before we proceed. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you once more for the opportunity, the privilege that we can come together before your throne of grace, power, and healing, oh God. Lord, oh God, there will be few more days, God, before this nativity, God. Lord, we give you praise today that we can come to you before your throne with this prayer, God, to rule our heart tonight and soul that we may celebrate Christmas in a manner pleasing to you, God. Lord, fill our heart tonight with a genuine spirit of Christmas, which rejoices in the redemption of our sin, God. Pardon of our transgression against you, and the life eternal, O God, offered to us, Lord, by you, God, through coming as a baby in a manger, God. Lord, let the significance of Christmas never be small by the activities of the festive season that we have right now, nor the worries or the cares or perplexing cares that would rob us, Lord, of our Christmas joy, God. Lord, oh God, let your light and your salvation come forth, oh God, upon the people, oh God, of this nation and all over the world, God, for your glory, for your honor, oh God. Lord, bless the word that I'm going to share tonight. Let it be, Lord, oh God, let it be anointed, oh God, through you, God, so that people will hear that, will be, Lord, oh God, will be appreciative of your presence on this prayer line tonight. In Jesus' precious holy name, amen. Hallelujah. The title of the message, again, is He Came to Fulfill the Promise. What do you consider most significant about Christmas? You know, for some people, maybe visiting with relatives could seem very important. Or perhaps a few would even admit they like the opportunity to ask for things they would not dare to request at any other time. But Christmas is far more than just an event or a December holiday with time off from work. It is a personal promise from God to mankind. That's why the title of the message tonight is, He Came to Fulfill the Promise. That's why the significance of this very special day is embodied in two scriptural names and applies to each of us, or believers, every day of the year. In the chapter of Matthew, the first chapter of Matthew, chapter 1, an angel of the Lord told Joseph that Mary, his betrothed, would bear a son conceived of the Holy Spirit. You can find it in the book of Matthew, chapter 1, verse 21. So he instructed Joseph to name the child Jesus and announced that the birth would fulfill Isaiah's prophecy. They shall call his name Emmanuel, which translated means God with us. You can find that in the book of Isaiah chapter 7 verse 14. Notice here that the passage here did not say, Joseph, you are to decide what he will be called. The unborn child already had a predetermined name, okay, which indicated who he was and what he was to do. So if we examine, just examine the two names in this passage, Jesus and Emmanuel. These are the two names, Jesus and Emmanuel. We will be able to understand what really took place the night our Savior was born. Okay, now the name Jesus is the more familiar one. Everyone knows Jesus. So it is Greek word translated in the Old Testament Hebrew word which means Joshua, okay? Meaning the Lord is salvation. So when the angel said, "You shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." So he was pointing to the significance of that original Christmas. God provided for our sin, your sin, as well as for the sin of the world, either its past, present, and future. You know, take note of this. 700 years before Christ's birth, Isaiah already prophesied was a word of hope and encouragement to Judah as it faced a great crisis during that time. So Isaiah, the prophet's message was an indication of what God was about to do, as well as what would ultimately be fulfilled in the Messiah's birth or advent. So Emmanuel, the name Emmanuel, is full of promise. It was God's way of assuring the Old Testament saints that he was with them. Emmanuel is always with them. That's why taking together these two names, remember this, encompass what we need our entire life. Jesus, just remember, Jesus is the pardoner, the one who pardon our sins. And Emmanuel, the divine presence within us, to what? To help, to guide every moment of everyday life. That's why the names and the promises inherent in them are the foundation for every action life of a Christian. So how did God engineer the first Christmas to fulfill the promises of Jesus in Emmanuel? So his method, God's method, was the incarnation, okay? Incarnation, a term familiar to us all, okay? But one that most people understand only very little. That's why on the night Christ was born, the eternal Father, motivated by love, entered into the human family. He was supernaturally conceived of the Holy Spirit and physically born to a virgin. So Jesus, remember this, Jesus never ceased to be God. And he remained perfectly sinless in his being. So if the incarnation did not take place, what it means if the Lord did not become in the flesh as a baby, exactly as it did, then we would still be living in our sin. That's why in the book of Romans chapter 6 verse 23, according to the scripture, the punishment for sin is death. And in the book of Deuteronomy, the Bible also says that God rejects any imperfect sacrifice. How? Why? Jesus, because of his absolute sinlessness without sin, is the only one who could save you and me and all of us, offering himself as payment for our sin. That's why if we go back to the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve fell, sin tainted the entire human race. So you might ask, you know, in the book of Philippians chapter 2, you might ask, if Jesus was human as well as divine, how did he avoid having a sin nature like the rest of us? So Philippians chapter 2 verse 6 explained that in order to redeem mankind, God chose to humble himself in the person of Jesus Christ, taking on the form of a bondservant, that is the almighty sovereign of this universe, voluntarily laid aside his glory so that he could be born physically like any other baby. So he gave us his throne of glory in heaven to come and be born physically here as a baby on earth. Can you imagine that? Oh, hallelujah. Being conceived of the Holy Spirit, he did not inherit the sin nature and was therefore able to offer himself as the acceptable, perfect sacrifice our sin debt required. The requirement is a acceptable, perfect sacrifice in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, Christmas was not just the birth of a baby. Remember this. It was the birth of God in human flesh. Jesus Christ was God before he became that infant. And he was God at his conception. In his childhood, he remains to be God. And throughout his manhood, he is God. He always has been and forever will be the eternal God of this universe. So Jesus was born into this world for the purpose of what? Dying in your place and in mine. So he placed his body upon the cross by an act of his own will. So had he not been Almighty God, his death would have been no more noteworthy than that of the two thieves or criminal crucified alongside him. That's why his incarnation make it possible for us who live here on earth to live there in heaven with him eternally. Hallelujah. So that is what make Christmas so significant. It's so important. That's why apart from the birth of God in human flesh, in Jesus Christ, there is no salvation, no hope, no future for anyone who has ever lived here on earth. Unless God become flesh, every one of us, you and me, even on this prayer line, would have to stand before the Lord with all of our sin resting upon us. And our sin would separate us from God. That's why Isaiah 59 verse 2, the incarnation is the promise of Jesus, the Lord of our salvation, for every person in the world. You know, as wonderful as it was that Christ willingly came to die for your sin, for my sin, but that was not the full extent of God's awesome plan. God has an awesome plan. That's why he sent his only begotten son to earth as a baby. He had far more in mind than simply our future well-being to be with him eternally. Remember this. He also promised us his presence, which was fulfilled in the birth of Emmanuel. Jesus was God with us. That's what it means with Emmanuel. The name Emmanuel, God is always with us, who physically lived and walked among men to show us what the Heavenly Father is like. So, but more than that, God was concerned about mankind in all ages and in every age, not just those living in this first century or this century that we are in. So before his crucifixion, Jesus encouraged his disciples, remember? And through the scripture likewise encouraged you and me with a promise that he will fulfill it. That's why he came, to fulfill his promise. So he has said that when he went away in the book of John 14 verse 17, this is his promise. He would ask the Father to send the Spirit of truth who abides with you and will be in you. To what? To teach, to remind, to comfort, and to guide every step of the way, all the way. It's far better than God simply being with me. God is being in me. Can you imagine that? Not only God, Emmanuel, is not only God with me. God is in me. God is for me. God is to me. God is through me. Oh, hallelujah. And that is his promise to you.
Come on, baby.
To me. The incomparable, supernatural, immeasurable God will take up residence in you.
Yeah, baby.
And everything we need,
Mom,
he will fulfill it. That
Dabber
is
top.
A large concept to grasp tonight. Everything you
Love
need, he will provide. He will reside inside of you. So the God who made the star, the universe, is living on the inside of you. Can you imagine that? The one who made the whole universe is inside of you. And we don't have a single need that he cannot satisfy.
Sorry, baby, I didn't want you
Just
to get
imagine
burnt.
That once he is within you, there will never be time you have to take a step without him. He will be always with you. That's what it means with the name Emmanuel. Hebrew chapter 13 verse 5. That's what Christmas is all about. His promise that he will fulfill it. God coming to live within and through each one of us. That is why we can say tonight, Galatians 2:20, hallelujah, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. This is the promise of God. He wants to reside in you. He wants to live in you forever. That's why when you are sick, the great physician is with you to heal you. When you are weak, the great strengthener is available to strengthen you. When you are discouraged, Jesus is present to encourage your heart. When you are tempted, he is there to overcome through you and for you. When you are rejected, Jesus Christ is at hand to remind you of his acceptance. When you are struggling financially, remember this. He is there assuring you that he is your source. When you face decision at work or at home or anywhere else, Jesus is close by to provide wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. When you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, what? He is right by your side to remind you. He will be your sufficiency. He will be your protection. When no mere man is adequate to comfort and assure you of protection. That's why in the light of the one of this promise of God that he is going to fulfill, that's why he came. Believers should be confident and courageous, be bold. What cause have we have to worry now or fear when the sovereign almighty God is within you? We should be reassured because he is adequate to come us through any trial, any testing, any hopelessness, any helplessness that comes your way. and with your tail at peace, because there's no storm, there's no trials of life, there's no difficulties that he is powerless to come. So this year, 2014, as you gather together on Christmas Day, I encourage you in your family to kneel and give thanks to the Almighty God, who will fulfill His promise in your life. There is nothing wrong with the gifts or festivity as long as they don't crowd out what belongs in first place: Jesus. Christmas is about God breaking into humanity, shattering time, and becoming life and hope and help to all. That's why He is the reason for this season. You know, the first century Nazareth was not a place most of us would choose to spend our Christmas holiday. Amen? The city catered heavily during that time to soldier, transient soldier, tradesman, businessman accessing its port. This is Nazareth during the time of Jesus. It is likely that the district reputation lead to Nathaniel saying, "Can any good come out of Nazareth during that time?" That's why there's no good thing coming out of Nazareth during that time. You can find that in the book of John, chapter 1, verse 46. This is where Mary, the mother of Christ, lived on a cold winter night. Remember this, 2,000 years ago, Mary and Joseph traveled 90 miles on foot with the help of a few donkeys to Bethlehem. They likely followed the bank of the river of Jordan, and they may have slipped under a tree for shelter because nights in the hill country were frequently cold and rainy during that time. Just imagine what I'm saying right now, their struggle going to Bethlehem. So Mary arrived in Bethlehem 9 months pregnant, having made an incredibly difficult journey, 90 miles across the desert. The city was teeming with travelers, and the young couple, Mary and Joseph, could not find no vacant inn or hotel. That's why, desperate for a place to rest, they ended up in a stable, in a manger where animals gathered. It was here, in the darkness of a damp, dreary, smelly stable, that our Savior entered the world. There was no ceremony during that time when the Lord Jesus arrived as a baby. No trumpets, no announcement. His entrance, there's nobody knows. No entourage to escort the King of Kings. No welcoming committee to receive Jesus. Only Mary, Joseph, and few animals were present at his birth. So why would a sovereign heavenly Father choose to deliver His Son, the Savior of all mankind, to the world in such a humble fashion? Why? Why would the Father would do that to His Son? Couldn't He just as easily have been born in a hotel or temple, or even presented to Jewish high priest to take care of Him, or even to the Pharisees and Sadducees with fine homes? Why not sending thundering angels into the palace of King Herod and demand homage to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords? So why use lowly people from Nazareth to usher him in? And here is the reason. The reason is that his mercy, the Lord's mercy, reaches to the poorest of the poor as well as to the richest of the rich. Notice the angel's report. Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David, this is in Luke chapter 2 verse 10, there has been born for you a Savior. This is the fulfillment of the promise of God. A Savior who is Christ the Lord. He came for all of us, you and me, who are defiled, who are sinful, who are unclean. He came for us. That's why on that extraordinary night in Bethlehem, the Word was transformed. Christ's love stripped man, made away the boundaries, have broken the walls of race, of class, economic status, and every other man-made category that divides the people. This is the night to remember. The night that the Lord Jesus Christ will fulfill or have fulfilled the promise. Jesus did something that had never done before. He enabled men and women to see the Father in him in a new way. You know, in the Old Testament, some people were confronted with God, but they could never look fully upon his glory. Remember Moses, who is described as God's friend, had opportunity to look upon God's back only, not the face. But here, the image of God can be seen in Jesus. You know, in the book of Colossians chapter 1, describes Jesus as the firstborn of all creation. This does not mean he was the first thing to be created. John 1 teaches us that he was always present with the Father. And there was never time when Jesus, as God, did not exist. He'd been existing with the Father and the Holy Spirit. So why then doesn't everyone place their faith in Jesus? Why? The heartbreaking answer is that Satan, the God of this world, has blinded people to the truth. Remaining blind to Jesus places a tremendous responsibility upon you and me. Rather than seeing God through Christ, what happened? We attempt to see him through our own lives. We devise a God of our own choosing, one who likes what we like and hates what we hate. That's why our own fallen, sinful nature, however, cannot be trusted, and we end up missing God completely. But Jesus Christ is our cornerstone. If we falter on a clear understanding of who he is, he actually is, nothing else we do in our life will ever matter. That's why he came to fulfill his promise to you and me, to humankind, to mankind, in Jesus' precious holy name. Amen. This is the end of our sharing tonight. Let me just close up in prayer. Hallelujah. Lord, there's a few more days before we can celebrate actually the day of Christmas. But we come to you tonight with earnest prayer to rule our heart now in our soul, that we may celebrate Christmas in a manner pleasing to you. So I pray tonight that you'll fill our heart with a genuine spirit of Christmas, which rejoices in the redemption from our redemption of our sin, in the pardon of all our iniquities that He offered to all men that will come at your manger, Lord. They're coming to your manger tonight. Let the significance of Christmas never be slow or dwarfed by all the activities of this season, nor the worries and cares. Rob us of Christmas joy and rejoicing of your coming. So Lord Jesus, our Savior and our God, you have given yourself for us to cleanse us from all iniquity. Grant that we may not look forward to your glorious appearing on that day when you will take us, all believers, to the everlasting Christmas joy. Where? In our Father's home, in heaven. So Jesus, we stand in spirit before your lowly manger, O God, and we bow our knees like the three kings, Lord, who visited you, God, in reverence, in worship of your birth in Bethlehem stable, together with all those animals around you, God. So may this coming Christ as a child this Christmas give us a different meaning now of celebrating it with loved ones and friends with true joy. And Lord, bless us that we can celebrate His first coming to bear our sins and the second coming to reward us, Lord. So equip us now, Lord, to be ready and work effectively in this last hour of the last day, even as we celebrate Christmas. We know, Lord, that in the past we walk according to the appearance and course of this world, but because you bore our sin, you set us free. And that's the fulfillment of your promise to each and every one of us, for your glory, for your honor, in Jesus' precious holy name. Amen. Hallelujah.